Welcome to Dollar Views. I'm Brian Gillis.
And I'm Stephen Maltmanex.
We're just a couple of Long Beach State film grads with a lifelong passion for cinema trying to put our money where our mouths are.
And we decided to make our BAs mean something by offering our spoiler-free take on the latest film releases.
Plus, any other media we've ingested over the past week.
Whether that's the latest buzzworthy show,
an album that's been on constant rotation,
that indie darling no one can shut up about,
a cute romantic comedy,
or the latest Michael Bay masterpiece.
We go over it all, $1 at a time. So we saw this fucking thing, even though we said on air, I don't know how many times that we wouldn't see it.
I know I did at least twice. Like, I mean, with all the fucking comments online, this is the last I want to talk about it, but just the backlash on this movie, I think that's really the main reason I went, was just because a part of me just wants to prove people wrong. And I mean, even when you go on fucking Letterboxd, one of the top reviews literally just starts off saying, I have not seen this movie yet, but he's giving it 5 stars anyway. Just to fucking prove a point. Yeah, like the conversation on this is really fucking ridiculous right now.
I don't think... this is the only conversation I've had about it. I hope it's the only one I have. It's a good movie.
It's okay. I think the first half, I definitely thought, like, you know, it was enjoyable and it was a good movie, even if it just kind of felt like... Well, I mean, let's just... Aside from the fact that they wanted to get women in there... That's probably the most successful part about this movie, and the best thing about it is the cast. But I mean, all the stuff that Paul Feig said, that I was mostly looking forward to—the fact that he wanted it to be scary—it's
not fucking scary.
How it built it up. Like, because you know, the first Ghostbusters. I mean, yes, I saw it as a kid, but it's still, it definitely knows.
Movie. It's a spooky movie, like the whole Keymaster thing, like that whole thing with Sigourney Weaver.
I mean, yeah, that scene, it creeped the fuck out of me as a kid.
Damn scary.
You know, like that is part of what made you really believe in that world and in that danger. And honestly, that's just what made it even more funny, because while shit was just really, really spooky, which you use the perfect word for it. Like, the comedy was there for relief, and that just made it really, really effective. Here, it's not a modern thing or a CGI thing, but it's just there is no anticipation for any of, you know, these supposed scary moments. Like, there was one moment in the beginning.
I like the way it started. Yeah, I really like the way it started with Zach Woods, the guy who fucks from Silicon Valley, who is in, like, every Paul Feig movie now. He was in Spy. He's the guy the bartender that roofied. Rose Byrne. I haven't seen The Heat, but I know he's in that. But I really like that little soft open welcome to Ghostbusters world thing in the haunted mansion with the painting.
Like, it obviously doesn't compare to the library, but it's pretty fun. Yeah, I'll agree with you there.
It's really good. Like, it did really set the tone. I was like, okay, it's kind of funny, but this is, you know, like there's a really good atmosphere here. Like, you know, it's not Crimson Peak or anything, but I was still buying into we're in a haunted New York still, even if it's not the one that Ivan Reitman helped
it's
produce.
Definitely lighter.
Like, it's a different one. There's obviously supernatural elements here because there are ghosts, but it doesn't have that X-Files thing going for it that the original films went, because we got to put it out there. This is exactly as Angry Video Game Nerd saw it. This is a straight-up reboot/remake. There's no ties besides the obvious cameos that connect this to the world. It's a different New York. It's a different world. It wasn't retcon, but it was Sony basically going, you know, we bought Columbia Pictures after Ghostbusters. Let's not try to capitalize on that in any way. Which I thought was pretty weird, especially with how big some of the cameos are. Because Bill Murray's in this, and he's not a cameo.
No,
he's
has
a straight-up character.
Pretty important role. I mean, I loved what they did with him. I thought it was absolutely hilarious, the payoff for that. But the other cameos, though, they really... It's difficult for me not to believe that, like, in some way, you know, you could say this is connected... Maybe in a parallel universe or something. I mean, there are things that it just references the original, like... I don't know, too many ways. Like, this is something that's just really bothering me is how self-referential, like, this movie is. I mean,
these kind of films always kind of are, though, when it's the... Because it's not quite, you know, Star Wars Episode 7 or Terminator Genesis, but it's in the same kind of realm. It's, like, closer to Mad Max Fury Road than those are in terms of kind of off-branching from the franchise. Yeah. And yet it still, like, pays its respects with, you know, Dan Aykroyd is a cab driver and Bill Murray has a big important role. Annie Potts has basically, she's doing the exact same thing she does in those two Ghostbusters movies from the 80s.
But the thing is, though, with those movies that you brought up, like even Terminator Genesis, which while I wasn't so big on, at least those movies tried to do something new and impress us with something different. But, like, I feel like all this had were references, and then it just kind of went by the checklist of, oh, let's do a Ghostbusters movie and let's do the same thing. Like, you know, yes, there's variations in plot, but at the end of the day, it just felt like the same movie, and clearly they were having fun making it, but there was...
It's a very lazy Ghostbusters.
Very uninspired, and that really, really just makes me so sad, because I want to like this.
But the problem is that it's a really fucking funny movie.
Oh, yeah.
I was laughing a lot. Like, as soon as it started, even with the spooky stuff in the whatever the house is called, the manor or whatever, almost all of it, especially Chris Hemsworth stuff.
Yes,
I couldn't believe how much I was laughing. It surprised me in the same way that Bridesmaids and Spy did, where I went into this knowing, you know, oh, it's the same director, I'm probably gonna like it for those reasons. That's why I bought a ticket, and I bought a 3D ticket at that. I didn't get a free offer.
How did that look?
I didn't buy the Blu-ray and save bucks. It looked great. It was really fantastic. They had some sections. Obviously, there's a lot of depth going on. But they had some sections where the effects were coming out of the screen. There wasn't a lot of it, but it was there. They had some really interesting stuff where, like, the letterbox framing on the projection, some of the elements would hang either above or below, especially with, like, lightning effects later
on
with the proton packs.
Movies
like,
have been
those
doing
would.
That, like, lately, and that's.
Yeah.
Like, Fury Road did that.
Yeah, it was really, really cool usage. Like, I definitely would go see this in 3D Slimer, get some cool stuff, the Stay Puft Marshmallow. It's really great 3D, even though it's post-converted, especially for the ghost effects. Any kind of CG work, it looks great. And then even just practical gags, there's a couple things that work well. The weirdest thing about the 3D is that I got a trailer for Billy Lynn's long halftime walk.
Oh, how'd that look?
That wasn't in 3D.
Oh, really?
Not only was that trailer not in 3D, it didn't say, oh, by the way, this was shot in 3D or in 4K or in HDR or it has a high frame rate. It didn't say any of that shit. It just said coming soon, and I was really let down. This is the first time I'd seen any footage of the film. I'd just seen a couple of stills, and I couldn't believe that they dropped the ball that hard.
Wow.
That I could have bought a ticket that day if I got to see the real footage. I'm guessing it's because they don't want to... I don't know, actually. I have no guess. I was really
surprised.
If they
don't say anything in the end of the trailer, then they're not really pushing it.
But you know that they're going to push this. That CinemaCon, they pushed the shit out of that. Like, when they showed the first footage, and then they had projector problems or whatever.
Well, I mean, it's just it definitely alienated some people, so I don't know if exhibitors are that into it, or maybe just the cost of upgrading projectors is...
I'm not
too
sure.
Much.
Maybe I know I'm gonna go.
Expensive, but it'll be easier for you to see it in LA, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm gonna see it in LA for sure. Probably at the TCL or somewhere. But I'm gonna go get the full experience. I didn't do it for the Hobbit films. I'm gonna do it for this one. I want to see what Ang Lee can do. But this isn't about him. This isn't about that other Sony film that's coming out this year. But yeah, it wasn't a bad movie. I knew it wasn't going to be great. I thought it was going to be okay, and I guess it was a little bit above
that.
Well,
I got to say, going back to the... You brought up 3D. Mm-hmm. Did that... Like, did you at least enjoy the action sequences? Because I honestly... Maybe I would have enjoyed it more. I was very unimpressed with the
that
CG.
Final act
didn't expect
is horrible.
To be wowed or anything.
No, the whole blockbuster moment that happens at the end when the team, you know, they get back together and they do the montage and they get their gear and they stop the ghost. That was so fucking boring. Like, the action wasn't cool or unique.
Whole third act in
general.
It felt very, very paint by numbers, and that's where the movie really went down for
me. The couple of reviews I've read on Twitter and on the internet, they kind of are saying the same things we are right now, where it's like, the cast is great, you know? Kate McKinnon, amazing in this film. She could get, like, a Golden Globe nomination. Like, Leslie Jones, she's not just the black person. Like, she's better than Ernie Hudson is. Kristen Wiig and Melissa McCarthy. We already know their chemistry from, you know, Bridesmaids.
Mm-hmm.
And the main cast is fantastic. Chris Hemsworth, amazing in a straight-up just comedic role. Much better than in Vacation. But something I was trying to mention earlier, you know, we talked about it on 2 cents, maybe even in dollar reviews, about how this is basically the same exact weekend as Pixels. It's another huge tentpole for Sony, another 3D movie with a lot riding on it. This is miles above Pixels.
I mean, I sort of had the same thought definitely while I was watching that it was similar, at least as far as...
The reason exists.
I don't know. You know, I was kinder to the action scenes in Pixels.
Because they're more interesting
like,
there.
And
the 3D was awesome.
I don't remember them at all, though. And, like, I, you know, honestly, like, they kind of reminded me of the third act of this movie. So, I mean, that's definitely speaking about, like, you know, this movie's miles above that for sure, but...
I think it's the script for one thing.
I really want to be kinder to this, though.
Katie Dippold, I still haven't seen The Heat, but I read before we recorded that she worked on Parks and Recreation. I'm sure her episodes, I think she did, like, 8 or 9. I'm sure I love those episodes. And she can clearly write funny comedy. And not just that, but starring women. Because, yes, this is the she-make. This is the female Ghostbusters movie. But it doesn't make a big thing about that. It never...
Well, it definitely references internet comments.
But
I mean, that's a thing
it's like
in the
a
movie,
very,
it's very much echoing...
It's a very minor joke, though. You know, they didn't really make a big deal about
it. Yeah, but I mean,
film,
also,
they
thing. Do make it a big deal in the movie, though, that they are just four women
just,
that
yeah.
nobody should be listening to. Like, that's... It's very much
well, that's when the,
self-aware.
No, that's when the movie starts getting bad, though. Like, once Andy Garcia is introduced, the movie just turns into shit. Like, when you learn...
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the more interesting elements of the movie, I would say. But it's just... I don't know. Like, that is my problem with this, I guess, is just really... I really felt it here, especially, that now I'm just getting tired of remakes and reboots and, like, really just properties that are being brought back and offering no surprises whatsoever and just making minor differences. And it's cool, I guess, if you want to see a slightly different version of the movie... And there are people that definitely enjoy stuff like that.
Well,
but...
it's an interesting update, not because it had to be made, but I'm interested in what they do with it. You know, Sony, they have Spider-Man, which they don't really own. That's a Marvel property. They have Men in Black and 21 Jump Street, which are, you know, being fused together in the near future. But outside of those, Ghostbusters really, like, its only other real thing. They don't have really any franchises that they can work with anymore. And the fact that this had that ghost core before the film started, we know that an animated...
Yeah, which, what was that?
There's an animated movie being made. I think they're trying to make a cartoon. I'm sure that they're doing merchandising. They clearly have the Ghostbusters Dimension thing at Madame Tussauds
in
New
York. When I saw that logo, I was wondering, wait, did I miss a piece of information that we did on 2 cents? Because I don't remember that happening.
We kind of skirted around it. I know Paul Feig and Ivan Reitman, they're involved with that. I'm sure other people are too. But they're trying to, you know, make this not into a shared universe necessarily, but they're trying to make it a franchise, like something that Sony can make a lot of money off of. They put out
I'll bet, because they definitely need something.
They put out a real stupid, like, tie-in Activision game for this. But between the cartoon that's coming out and the animated movie, and like I said, the Ghostbusters Dimensions VR experience that The Void put out, it seems like they got their hearts in the right place. It's just they didn't know how to make a good movie. All right, it's not a bad movie. It's just... It's not a blockbuster.
I mean,
it's not a...
Well, I mean, they're having fun with the movie, and people are responding positively to it.
Which makes sense, because it's a fun movie.
I don't want to say the movie's bad. It's just, it's very, very safe.
Yeah.
You know, like, people were applauding in my theater at the end
Why?
Of this movie. And so, everyone's clearly enjoying it, at least here, anyway. So, I can't, you know, I'm not going to say that they're wrong, but... I definitely laughed during the movie, but I was just left very, very unfulfilled. And for me, I think it's just definitely a matter of taste. It's the type of movies that I'm just starting to get very, very tired of seeing. Like, I have not seen that many big budget blockbusters this summer. You look at the box office, clearly summer tentpoles are not doing that well. So many of them are underperforming.
Unless it's animated.
And the stuff that I'm just getting more and more into is, you know, the releases like Swiss Army Man or The Lobster or even some by Warner Brothers like The Nice Guys, you know, the smaller mid-ground stuff. Like, that's my summer that I'm enjoying right now. but nothing big aside from probably, I don't know, Captain America, like, has really, really gotten me excited.
You, it seemed like you kind of like X-Men too.
Oh, yeah,
but
yeah, that too.
It's really weird the way Sony is kind of spinning the success of this film, because it has a good cinema score grade. I think it's like a B+. But it's poised to be the number one this weekend. I'd be really surprised
if
it isn't.
But what
they're
I'm
already
is that,
calling it...
what's it called? Secret Life of Pets. I think it's going to go neck to neck with that. Unless this has a great Saturday gross, then we'll see.
Because animated is doing so well this year, the way Sony is going to call it, like on the trail, like commercials and stuff, when it's like, oh, number one comedy of the summer... in the trades, Sony's calling it the number two live-action non-superhero film of the year behind Jungle Book.
You know... All right, I wanted
so
to say,
silly.
I mean, technically it's a movie about heroes. I guess you can say that they're not superheroes, but...
They're humans.
I don't know, but still, that's like saying Batman is... you know, not a superhero, and you know, they got just as much cool tech as he does, and they don't have masks.
That's still a Superman and Wonder Woman movie, So you know, that's a straight up superhero movie. But it's funny the route they have to take to try to make this a success.
I mean, just this movie. I mean, any movie in general. Like, this has been I don't know. I remember when I was first aware of, you know, box office grosses and all that, and like, I would laugh going like, ha, they can't use number one movie in America in the commercial, and then I see something like number one comedy in America. It's like, bullshit. They're looking for anything to
number
make themselves
number one original
look good.
Comedy in America. It's like number one remake this weekend or something real stupid like that. And they don't have to say in the world for this one, because I don't know if you saw, but this isn't getting a Chinese release, which is really strange. Especially after Pixels a year ago, you know, Sony cut that movie to shreds to make sure it could play in China.
I'm not surprised, I guess. I mean, whenever I hear Chinese release, I think there has to be something that appeals more towards China, like, specifically. And I don't know. There's nothing outright offensive in this. Maybe it's just, you know, they only have a certain number
of films
not the reason. That they're willing to take in, and they've also got co-productions happening.
That's not the reason either. The reason behind it not getting a Chinese release is because it's a twofer. One, Chinese are really weird, especially the government, about supernatural elements. It's like a communism holdover. There was nothing. It was about living a secular life, like nothing to do with entities or spirits or ghosts or anything. But what the bigger thing is that the first two films in the franchise weren't big in China. So there's no reason to try to capitalize on that success to, you know, get Chinese money. And it makes sense, because this film, you know, if you are a diehard fan of those Bill Murray, you know, Rick Moranis films, Dan Aykroyd, Harold Ramis too. By the way, I love the way they paid respect to him in this film. Probably my favorite thing about it. If you're a fan of those, a diehard fan, and you don't want to see this, you're not going to. The people that are going to go see this, people that are going to enjoy it, the people that like Paul Feig's movies, the people that enjoy these SNL alumni / cast members and their comedy. If you're a fan of them, if you're a fan of him, or just the idea of the Ghostbusters coming back, you're going to enjoy it. Like, I doubt anyone who's seen this weekend so far, or who will see it, is going to hate it.
No,
it's not that
people applauded,
but it's not bad.
Theater. And like, this was a half full,
which I think
that
is fucking weird,
just based on the laughter and the applause. So it was a very positive response, and it definitely elevated
mine was
the experience for me.
I went to a, you know, one of the lay down recliner seats, so it was only 100-person capacity, but it was full, and everyone enjoyed it, even like the kids. Like, it, you know, it's a very good time. Just, you know, it's not The Nice Guys, it's not Swiss Army Man. It's better than Finding Dory, without a doubt. Like, that's a much lazier cash-in on the franchise, in my opinion.
I'm just, you know, there's so much more creativity happening in Finding Dory that I think I found that more enjoyable. You know, the laziness as far as the plotting in this just really got to me, which it's a shame, because clearly everyone is enthusiastic during this movie, and I mean, they are making it with love. I mean, there are a lot of cool things in there, but no, I'd pick Finding Dory over this easily. I mean, as far as all of Paul Feig's stuff, post whatever crappy Christmas Kids in an Airport movie he did that he shunned.
Did he do that unaccompanied?
Yeah, and then he didn't make a movie for years, and so I guess Bridesmaids kind of got him back on the radar.
I mean, he did a lot of Freaks and Geeks and stuff like
but
that.
But honestly, though,
I think he did a couple episodes.
Not to completely you know, not to give him no credit at all, but I love Bridesmaids, but I'm sure that's more Kristen Wiig and what's her writing partner's name? That's their movie. And ever since then, he's pretty much, Paul Feig's been doing movies that are a nod to some sort of genre, you know, The Heat being the buddy cop movie, The Spy obviously being a spy movie, and now, you know, we got Ghostbusters. Yeah. It's, so, you know, he's having fun with
that. Supernatural blockbuster.
Yeah, but, I mean, Bridesmaids is completely unrelated to those. I mean, I love Bridesmaids because, A, it's funny, and it's just a great drama, you know, it has a character that is very, very well, like, put out there and very, very relatable, regardless of gender. So, and I mean, that movie just felt very raw and real in a way that I really appreciated. You know, the other ones I like, but I would say this is probably a good example, too, of the kind of director that Paul Feig is and just what he's interested in now. But, and I'm not sure if I would say I'm a fan anymore at this point, even though I really love one of his movies, but I really want to get behind this movie too and just give it more credit, because there were cool things I liked in Spy and in The Heat as well, but it's just, this feels so slavish to the fact that it's a Ghostbusters movie, and it feels more like a fan film with a twist. And you know, the best thing about this movie is the chemistry of the four leads, and they really don't have anything to do with the brand at all. So I mean, it's
like the ladies here, they make it their own.
They do.
They really make it their own. And, you know, they could have easily just made it, you know, cast people that reminded us of the original Ghostbusters. And it doesn't do that. Like, it when they make the sequel, which they undoubtedly will do, I know you don't stay for credits for some reason, but there's a post-credit sequence here where they tease Zool and pretty much means that they're going to make a sequel. I mean, they already are working on the franchise, blooming it out, like I said. You know, they're going to try to get merchandise, the Halloween costumes, all that stuff this year. I'm sure there's going to be like SNL gags where they make an appearance together. I'm sure, I'm surprised they didn't actually do that to promote this film. And, oh, it's because the season's over for SNL. But, yeah, I wish I could love this film. I can't. I can't recommend it, but I think anyone that's interested is going to enjoy it. Like, you'd be hard-pressed to find someone that's like, that movie fucking sucked. It was a waste of money. Like, I completely forgot about any of my troubles or burdens or whatever when I watched it for that hour and 45 minutes or whatever. And even the credits were fun. Like, the credits were a dance sequence that was cut that was from the film. Funny. That really weird, where they're just standing there with their fingers up to the sky, and it's like, oh, well, they could have had this kick-ass dance sequence, and they had to cut it out.
I knew that
reason.
You would enjoy that.
The credits looked awesome in 3D, by the way. However they did, it was like the background was the dancing, and the foreground was the credits, but then those were moving left and right, and then there was like other elements, including like Slimer and some ghosts going around the frame.
Like, the most I could appreciate everything was just about this. The text for the credits rolling themselves, just kind of moving around the screen at some points. Yeah, that's the most I got.
It was really cool in 3D. Like, if you're going to see this, see it in that extra dimension, get a little bit more for your money. I can't buy it for a dollar, but I think anyone will have a good time with this one. Especially if you don't have any appreciation for the franchise, or if you're looking for a good remake. Like, if you just want, like, a fun summer movie, then you're going to enjoy it. Not as much as, you know, like, Civil War, but maybe more so than Dawn of Justice.
I mean, you know, it's funny that we're bringing up Civil War. I mean, I think this is a $150 million movie, and I'm just kind of amazed because it doesn't feel that expensive. In fact, it feels like it could have been done for cheaper. But I don't know.
Well, they did shut down a lot of New York City.
Yeah, I was actually just
going to
say, wait a minute. It looks like they shot in New York, so that's probably it.
Yeah, they definitely shot in New York. Well, they shot in Boston, too, but even still, it doesn't matter where it is. If you shut down a street like that, like, look at fucking I Am Legend, for instance. That movie cost so much money because they had to shut down Times Square. Like, anytime you do something like that, it's going to cost.
It was also amazing with Spider-Man 2, which was very expensive, and, you know, Sony's had experience with working in New York before, but, you know, Ghostbusters is not something I'm precious about. Like, I did watch it as a kid, and I have very fond memories of that movie scaring the shit out of me, but, you know, I'm not crazy about it. I still really enjoy the movie, so I'm not one of those people freaking the fuck out over it. I don't even...
I'm only like that about one Bill Murray movie, and it's Groundhog Day. Like, the rest of his filmography, it's not bad, but I'm not, oh my god, Ghostbusters, oh, I grew up on that. It's the funniest thing ever. I love the cartoon, I love all... Like, no. Yeah. I understand what it is. I know there's some. I know they're good movies. They're iconic. The theme song, for instance, like I was humming it all day today.
By the way, like, I gotta say, I know the Fallout Boy one just gets so much flack. And
it works great in the movie.
Exactly. Yeah, when it shows up in the movie, it's like, okay, you know what? This feels like a Ghostbusters movie, but it feels like it's updated in a way. And this is one thing where it feels like it's new and it feels like it's the same in a good way. Like, just doing its own thing. And I thought it was a very appropriate use of that song. It actually got me very excited for the sequence that was about to come up, and that was a really good sequence. This movie just doesn't really care about its plot, which, yeah, I know it doesn't seem like an important criticism, but it just doesn't want to surprise you, and it's weird because it tries to do new things, especially with the villain in this movie, which... I thought had a good
setup.
That's
the worst part of the fucking movie.
It had a good
setup. It's so bad, man.
I felt like it was going somewhere. I felt like it was going somewhere at first, and then it just fucking falls flat, and it's just like, we get this explanation. It's just given to us so easily, and it's like, yeah, I thought that there could have been something good there.
No.
Like, yeah, no, just the mystery unraveling before it, but then, yeah, it doesn't pay off nicely at all, and it just feels like it comes out of nowhere at the end of the day.
The more you see the villain, you go, okay, so the people that wrote this are really good at comedy. They do not know how to make anything feel spooky. They're not great at drawing, to a climax. They definitely can't write a bad guy, and for fuck's sake, like... It was insulting the way that here's the four girls that are the Ghostbusters, and then now we got this dweeb dude who's like not into them, and so he's the bad guy. Like, it was like a reversal.
It felt like it was on purpose, but I at least felt that the setup was there for even no matter how obvious it would have been, it could have felt interesting and it could have paid off nicely.
Maybe if he was an agent, if they tried to expand upon the franchise by like later on, like making little like a wink, like, oh, like he's working for so and so, or he's an entity of this
story. Like, I honestly
I'm just saying, if they had done that, it probably there is gonna be a sequel. It's a guarantee. It's gonna be 2019, I guarantee it. Summer 2019, Ghostbusters 2.
Well, I don't know, you know, who knows how well it's gonna do, because movies have not been doing that hot this year. But honestly, if it was more scary, like, that's the thing. Here's the thing. If James Wan directed this movie, even with the script that they have now, it could have been perfect. Like, because he has the action experience with Furious 7. He could have done a set piece like the one in the final act. You have all the leads being funny, and you have someone that knows how to build up anticipation and scares. Like, the only moment that I thought was very effective from a horror standpoint was just... It was close to in the beginning when they're in that mansion, and the door opens behind Kristen Wiig, and... It's just total silence. There's no score or anything happening in the background. And it adds this level of spookiness because it's unnerving when there is no sound. Like, that's another thing that this movie really bothered me with, especially, like, it is overscored. Like, you know, the score is just kind of generic, first of all, but it just doesn't go away. It's there for every big moment. And
that's a summer thing.
Like, I just really, I couldn't, you know, I might be throwing nitpicks, but just, like, I want this movie to be scary, especially because that's how Paul Feig, like, clearly said, you know, he wants it to be, I think they went as far as to say they want it to be scarier than the original, and, if he tried, you know, that's fine, but maybe the studio said, no, you can't go that far, and we might end up with an unrated version. I'm not gonna pray for that, but based on what I saw, I just don't think they succeeded on that.
The ghosts here look good. There's some real cool effects work being done, like when they're in the mirrors that are actually tanks in 3D.
It just kind of looked like generic ghosts to me.
I'm not saying,
you know,
just
it's,
those
it's
ghosts.
No different
like the
than looking at the Ghost of Christmas Past and the Robert Zemeckis Christmas Carol. That's what it felt like to me.
During the final action set piece, like, those floats look good, but there's nothing scary here, and I don't think it was ever supposed to be scary. But there's enough.
No, but you need
that
something
in a,
like.
in a couple of sections, you know, there's like some kind of lame jump scares. But the first couple times you see ghosts here, whether it's like the lady in the portrait or the electrocuted guy, like they, you know, they look kind of scary. Like you, there's something unnerving about them, just the way they're looking at you. You're like, oh, these are like bad ghosts.
Well, not to me, honestly. Like it could be the fact that I'm just not a kid anymore. And so, you know, what I experienced with the first Ghostbusters, that's going to be some kid's experience now. But I can only just try to articulate in the best way I can what my experience was with this movie. And it just left me feeling like very unfulfilled at the end of the day.
I enjoyed it. I mean, I didn't quite enjoy the money I paid. but it, like I said, it was a real fun watch in 3D, and I wasn't bored. You know, I wasn't unentertained. I just, you know, it's not something I'm going to sign up to be the fan club of. I'm not going to go buy a Ghostbuster t-shirt or anything. Like, I don't have a refueled interest in the franchise. Like, I'm sure I'll rewatch the first two films eventually, maybe even check out the cartoon. Like, hey, shout out to Tyler. I want to do your show again. But no, I mean, if its purpose was to get people or to remind filmgoers that Ghostbusters is a thing, I think it accomplished that feat. It was supposed to be a great blockbuster. It's not even close. But it is a funny movie. It is a fun movie. And at the very least, it gives a reason to see these actresses in something else. It proves that Paul Feig can tackle another genre. And I don't think it's a failure. It's just, it's a kind of eh movie. Like, it is a forgettable thing, despite being, you know, like, fine popcorn fare. Like, there's nothing bad about it.
Well, it's just
I think we were all kind of expecting something better, just in the way that, yeah, the backlash, how people were so like anti-women when it came to this film.
It's not just that, it's just the passion behind it. And I keep going back to that point. That was really the thing that gave me hope, was when Paul Feig said, I want to make this scary. Then it's like, you know, hey, that's someone going out of their comfort zone.
He had
to
make money.
Like, yeah, you know,
he was going to say whatever he had to ensure that it would make money.
Yeah,
it,
I know.
It,
like,
got your money.
Part of that is promotion, and, you know, like, but I, you know, this is one that I just sincerely, like, really bought what they were saying, and, like, I truly believe that that could be the intent, and that also shows that they had a good understanding of what the original one is. So, yeah, this movie, it just plays it safe, and I mean, it's fine. Some people will enjoy it. I wish I was there.
I think a lot of people enjoy it. I think that this is a crowd pleaser. It's just we're in a different crowd.
Yeah.
So, like, a final point I got here before moving on to other stuff we enjoyed this week. Slash Film had this real shitty article that I, like, skimmed for a second and then wished, like, almost sent some hate mail. Angie Hahn wrote this article called, like, characters, not so gay characters this summer, or some shit. It was like almost gay characters, or characters that aren't quite gay enough, or something. And this film is one of the films that is used as an example. Like, Kate McKinnon's character is almost a lesbian, but not quite, and that's a problem. It's like, what the fuck are they talking about? Like, she is an open lesbian.
I have not read the article, so I cannot comment on it.
Yeah,
but
it was the stupidest fucking thing I've ever seen. Like, the weirdest clickbaity thing ever. And I was just like, so? Does she have to be a lesbian just because she's giving these quote-unquote gay looks at some of her female friends? Like, is it a bad thing because they cast a openly gay woman in a role and she's not a gay character on film? Like, the Ghostbusters never had relationships. Close she got to a relationship was fucking Rick Moranis and Sigourney Weaver. I guess you could say, you know, Bill Murray. Sigourney Weaver, but she was never interested in him. She was interested in the Keymaster.
It ends with them not getting married.
But
they're celebrating.
But
right?
Happily ever after.
Yeah, they're all together.
And then she's not in the sequel.
I can't remember, but
I can't. Was she in the sequel?
I don't even remember. The sequel, by the way.
The sequel's bad. You don't have to. Like, there's like this. It basically, if I remember correctly, the first one.
Isn't it about their baby getting stolen or some shit?
No. If I remember correctly, the first one ends with, like, oh, like, you saved the city. And then the second one ends with the mayor going, You destroyed
spoilers.
The city, and then the tables are turned, and like the villain in the second one is a painting.
Man, I still have to see it, you know. Like, I know that it's mostly, you know, the big consensus on it is, like, it's not as good. Some people think it's outright terrible, and there's some people that have kind of enjoyed it as a supposed guilty pleasure. I'm sure it's not that
bad.
Put it
this way.
It's probably just the second one.
This is better than Ghostbusters 2.
Oh, then that makes me sad that I can't. I don't.
Yeah. Well. Yeah, you're probably not going to enjoy the second Ghostbusters. Yeah. It's not a bad
movie.
Maybe
we should have done that.
It's like this movie.
But yeah.
No, because I've already seen that. I don't want to really see it again. Yeah, Heaven's Gate is way better. So yeah, did you check out anything else this weekend? Any movies, TV shows, video games, podcasts?
Shit. Yeah, a few things. Nothing coming to mind right now to talk about.
So it's my turn? Okay.
Actually, I did see, well, you know what? Because you can see it on Amazon Prime if you want. But I saw this movie that is a really shitty slasher movie. You might enjoy it, though. It's called The Uninvited, the one from 1988. There's a bunch of movies with that title, but I stress that because this movie is about a mutated cat that just gets on a yacht and basically just takes out these college kids on spring break one by one along with this billionaire. And
why would you watch this?
I saw this on 35mm, and it's apparently the only print of existence because this movie originally came out on video because it was so bad. But seeing this with people, like in a sold-out theater, it is just a hilariously bad slasher movie, and it never, ever bored me. You can watch this on Amazon Prime if you want.
I think I will.
It's just so fucking weird. You know, the way I put it on Letterboxd
was... Tell Brennan over at Scream 101 podcast to do an episode on it.
Well, you know, I don't know if this is going to be, like... You might have to see this, because I know you love cats, but...
Not enough to see a slasher film starring a mutant cat.
Like, it's so fucking weird. But if you want, if you've been begging for an alien spinoff where Jonesy the cat gets impregnated by an alien, and then that alien kind of like just puts on a cat suit, and I don't know. There's so many weird parallels that could be comparable to Alien, because there was an almost chestburster scene in this. I don't know. This movie's just fucking weird, but. Yeah, that's the closest you're going to get to it. Like, it is just... seeing this with a crowd, it was just fucking hilarious. Like, you cannot help but laugh at the kills. I mean, it's like a mixture of Alien and Gremlins, I guess, but in a cat suit. And, like, you know, it even has the fucking head popping out of the cat's mouth. Like, it's just the weirdest fucking thing. And, yeah, this movie was released straight to video. But, honestly, like, just... You know, first off, I don't know if you know who Clue Gulager is. He's a guy that frequents the New Bev a lot. He's in this movie, and he's given, like, the weirdest set of fake teeth. and he just gets drunk all the time and gets the yacht lost in the middle of the ocean. I mean, and, you know, there's so much bad dialogue here. There's a lot of really funny... college slasher movie cliches, I guess, in this. Like, and yeah, this is technically a slasher movie, even if it is a fucking cat that's doing it. But this movie is fucking hilarious. You know, if you watch it at home, I can't say you won't be bored, but I saw this with a crowd, and it was consistently entertaining, and we were just laughing along with the insanity of this. And that's even when the kills weren't happening. So check it out if you want. It's on Amazon Prime, and it's also, you know, the best way that I was able to see it was on 35 on a surprisingly clean print, and the version that's on Amazon Prime, I looked it up real quick, and that's a VHS rip, so it's gonna look like shit if you watch it on there, but that's just...
It sounds like one of those movies that's so bad it's good, but if I watched it, I'd probably hate it so much that I'd turn it off.
I'd say get drunk and just watch it with a bunch of buddies on the couch and
no,
just
I'd rather
laugh
get
at
drunk
kills.
And watch Freddy Got Fingered.
I don't know.
Freddy Got Fingered today.
I quoted
Freddy Got Fingered, and no one knew what I was talking about. I was like, I saved the day. I saved the day. He's a baby boy. I saved the day, and
the,
like, no one knew what I was talking
about.
This
movie is really what kept me engaged with it. You know, it's absolutely stupid.
I'm a hero.
Freddy Got Fingered made me want to, yeah. Just thinking about Freddy Got Fingered makes me not able to complete sentences.
I'm going to get into some stuff I watched, but I bought some things this week. I went to a Goodwill outlet. They have a thing where it's like 4 movies for a dollar. They don't always have movies. So I got Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, 40 Days and 40 Nights, Elf, and Batter Santa for a dollar altogether.
Nice.
And it's like the Infinifilm version of Elf, if you remember what that was. Mm-hmm. The Bill and Ted's is like messed up. Like, big time, but I got it for 25 cents. So, yeah, it's not, you know, bad. I don't really give a shit. Like, it plays. So, like, every time I go there, you know, I buy a lot of clothes, as it's like a dollar a pound, but I can't not buy movies, too.
Yeah. I've never seen 40 out a couple Days and 40 Nights, by the way, so.
You need to. It's a really great Lent movie. I don't think you can say that about Lent. Like, there aren't many movies about it. It's like, what, Rent? It's like Rent and this. But real amazing, like Josh Hartnett at the peak of his career right before it tanked. Yeah, you should check it out. Him and Shannon Sossman, great chemistry, a real funny movie. Ends kind of weird, but great, weird, like sex rom-com. So I checked out some TV, though, and some music. I watched the first two episodes of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, you know, that Golden Globe winning musical on the CW. Mm-hmm. It's on Netflix now. Real weird. First off, I thought it was 30 minutes. It's an hour show, so there's a lot to commit there to a really weird premise. Here's the premise. It's like, this girl is a lawyer in New York. She's about to get promoted. Instead of taking the promotion, she runs into her ex-boyfriend from summer camp when she was 16, who's moving to Arizona. No. He's moving to, like, fucking West Covina. There you go. That she moves to West Covina, finds a job there, and then, like, does whatever she can to get him to fall in love with her again. And yet, there's, like, musical moments. It's real weird, like, pretty zany. The music's kind of funny, though. There's this, like, song in the second episode where he meets she meets his current girlfriend, and her song is like, I'm so good at yoga. Like, it's really fucking weird.
Sounds like
the
it.
Show is... It's a bonkers show, just not really my thing. Like, I can see myself turning it on, like maybe checking an episode out every once in a while, but I just wanted to see what it was. That's because it got so much acclaim and you know, the Golden Globe win and certain things like that, and I'm kind of like on a musical kick, but this one is a little too far-fetched for me. I might stop right where I left it, but it's definitely interesting. Like, it's worth looking into. The pilot less so than the second episode, but you know, it's something unique, and it's interesting that that's, like, one of the CW success stories. The other thing I saw, it's because, you know, just like my DVD purchases lately, I signed up for, like, a whole bunch of streaming services because they had free trials. Mm-hmm. So I got 4 months, I got 3 months of Spotify for $1. I got 4 months of Google Play Music for free, and that comes with a 4 month YouTube Red subscription. So I'm enjoying no commercials on YouTube. It's pretty nice. And so because of that, I checked out their biggest show. I might see another one. So I saw the pilot episode of Scare PewDiePie, someone who I fucking hate. I do not like his humor. I don't like the PewDiePie. I don't like anything about him. I don't like what he stands for. As someone who's done live streaming, I think he's a joke. But I want to check this out anyway. And it's like the stupidest fucking show. Do you remember that Fear Factor show?
Yeah.
Or, like, any of those sci-fi shows where basically, like, they would have people in a room and then everyone... It would all be, like, a really candid camera thing. Yeah. Yeah, it would be, like, I didn't mean Fear Factor. That's the Do This Win Money. I meant, shit, I can't... There was, like, Boiling Point. There you go.
Yeah.
It's basically Boiling Point starring PewDiePie. I know the other episodes are different. The first one's like a gag on a gag. Like the setup is that he thinks he's just going to the hospital to do some tests so he can, you know, do the show later in the week. It turns out that it was, you know, the whole thing's a prank. So they basically, you know, they try to scare him, and it's like kind of amusing, but not really. I can totally understand how fans of his millions of fans would really love it. But I was just like, yeah, this isn't bad, but why am I watching this? It was pretty bizarre. It's interesting, though, because it's YouTube Red and it has no commercials. There are commercial breaks, so the cutting's kind of okay. It's still a 24-minute runtime. I might check out another one. There's, like, four other episodes, I think, this season. But I still, you know, tune in for the weeks to come to see what else I watch on YouTube Red. I wish this, you know, that step-up show would be released during my trial period, but I know it won't happen. Dreams can't come true. But the only other things I've done this week, I've been listening to a lot of music. Mm-hmm. So over the past couple of weeks, a lot's been coming out. Avalanches put out their Wildflower album. Blood Orange put out Freetown Sound. I've listened to both of those like two or three times. This week, Schoolboy Q put out Blank Face LP. I've listened to that almost a full time now. Clamps Casino just put out his album. I haven't been able to hear that yet. It's like 32 levels. But Avalanches, that Wildflower, I was kind of not that excited about it. First off, like, backstory. Back in 2000, they're Australian group. They're not a band. They do plunderponics. And what that means is basically it's like sampling. They made an entire album just with samples. No live orchestration, nothing. It's just them taking sounds and putting them together and making and full on. More than that, though. Like, just a rhythm. Since I Left You album from two. No, it's like a full on album. Like, they create. They take, you know, these beats and melodies and they make the backing track, and then they time, like, vocal samples from the 1940s or 50s and put that on the music, and it sounds like something that they made, like real music. Like, if you didn't tell someone that it was made in that way, like, digging through crates and finding what works, and they're not unique in that fact. Like, there's other people like DJ Shadow and RGD2. Most hip-hop production, especially in the early days, is like that, except they did the vocals that way too. And so that first album is like an indie classic. You know, it's one of those things that, like, Pitchfork really made famous. So a lot of people have done it since then. And this new album is a lot different, most notably because they have featured performers, including, like, rappers such as Danny Brown and who else? MF Doom. And they have, like, Mercury Rev and a couple other artists on there. So there's actual vocals here that aren't pre-recorded, which is a little different. It took some getting used to. I think De La Soul has a song, too. But really good. Not a classic or anything, but some real standout tracks, like Frankie Sinatra, which is the first single. You can't not want to dance to that after you've heard it like five times. Real interesting. Like, give it a listen. Definitely listen to their first album if it sounds like something that you know, like, just from a production slash like editing standpoint. It's a marvel for how listenable it is.
Well, I definitely need some content on my phone while I'm on the way to work.
There you go. Yeah. Spotify or whatever. The other thing I listened to, Blood Orange's new album, which is what's this guy? What's his first name? It's like Devonton Hayes. And he's like worked with Beyonce and her sister. And he's like a songwriter. But then he has like this solo group. And this album's really interesting. It's not nearly as good as Cupid Deluxe that came out, I think, 4 years ago now. But there's some really great tracks. Like, when you get to the halfway mark, it turns into a whole nother album. Like, EVP is great. I can't remember the other names of the songs. It's like the one that I've listened to the most. And it might sound like I'm a dick rider because, like, Pitchfork just gave that a best new music. But yeah, some real great. Like, it's kind of hard to describe what kind of music it is. Like, it's pop in its sensibility, but it's deeper than that. And there's like some anti-oppression things going on. Like, the thesis of the album is like, don't tell me that I'm not black enough, that I'm not gay enough, that I'm not a man enough because I don't do this. And so it has a lot to say, like most albums do currently, about, you know, hands up, don't shoot, or Black Lives Matter. There's some interesting like samples there too, but a real interesting groovy album. Like, it has some disco sensibilities to it, some just like 80s electronic music. Real good. I listened to the Sing Seward album the other day too. That's a lot. But you're gonna say something?
Yeah, I forgot to mention this. I was gonna talk about Tickled real quick, and you know the reason why I forgot is because we talk about movies, but I feel very funny reviewing documentaries, so I just don't do it.
You can't really review a documentary.
Well, yeah, no, it's like, I think I did talk about Hoop Dreams last year on Two Cents when I saw it for the first time. But
did you?
I know I definitely saw it while we were doing the podcast, but I think, I don't know, it's just, it's harder to talk about a documentary right when it comes out with stuff that's still going on, especially when, you know, there are things that happen online, like the subjects of this movie showing up at a screening, and then, you know, which, if you have seen Tickled, then I recommend seeking that out, because it's still, you know, a continuing development in this story, and I don't feel I can judge like a documentary in any artistic sense like I do a narrative film, because the subject matter of the documentary just supersedes any importance, you know, over the medium itself. Like, that tends to be a more important issue. So I just gotta say, you know, just see Tickled. Like, it'll probably, HBO Films put this out, so it's probably going to be on HBO Go at some point, but seriously, just see this movie. Like, you don't have to go right now, but keep it on your radar so that when it comes out, if it comes your way, you can check it out. That's all I'm going to say.
You know, as someone who's worked on a documentary, you know, slaved away on one for 6 months of my life to make, you know, a 20-minute thing.
Mm-hmm.
It really turned me off of the documentary mode and just like non-narrative films in general for the longest time, because I realized how much you fuck with things, how much you manipulate reality to fit your artistic sensibilities, like switching around dialogue so it's more coherent, or making someone say something that they might not have said, and it's all okay because they signed a waiver and they were getting paid perhaps, and they were definitely getting notoriety because they're on camera.
Well, it's funny, there is part of that controversy after the fact of whether some of the stuff is legitimate, but I mean,
it's always a question.
Just any documentary, though, like anything film related, it's all manipulation. Just I still think that even if there's like little moments in Tickled, if you want to argue like, oh, that seems a bit convenient, the final thesis of the movie is still very much worth talking about, regardless of if you want to question facts with this or any other documentary.
I don't really watch reality TV. I never really have. But, you know, if I'm passing through a room and, like, my parents are watching something and, for instance, like, they're watching some stupid, like, car show on Velocity the other day where the owner of the shop walks in and he's like, or some guy that worked there, and he was like, where's so-and-so? And then they walk into the next room and they're like, where's so-and-so? They do it again. And, of course, the camera's set up to get the framing perfect on all three occurrences. I'm like, I'm sorry. I can't watch this.
Yeah.
This is definitely... you know, shot this way. This wasn't done in a single take.
Well, we're talking they about, told, you're talking about a reality show, though, not a...
I'm just saying, reality... Reality TV and documentary movies are pretty close. The difference is that because one is an hour and a half without commercial breaks, it seems more artistic.
All right, yeah, but I mean, this movie literally has cameras, like, some of them are GoPro, and some of them are literally hidden in coffee cups, just to be, you know, gorilla. I mean, it's... Mm-hmm. Like, it's not like Kevin Smith's comic book men were, you know, some supposed quote-unquote customers walk into the store and they start haggling, you know, to sell
everyone
something.
On that fucking show knows they're on the show. I've seen call ads out online. Like, Kevin Smith has tweeted one before. It's like, do you have a superhero merchandise that you really love that you want to sell and you have access to Red Bank, New Jersey? Come on down. Be on my TV show. It's like, that's how reality works. That's how reality always works. You want proof? Why would someone not blur their face out? Like, when you watch a documentary and you see all the guys in the background, you don't know what they actually look like. That's because they got pranked or whatever, and they're like, no, I'm not going to give you my likeness. Fuck that. That's not happening. And so they don't allow themselves to be seen, or at least they're censored in some way. Yeah. That doesn't happen in reality.
I mean, that is something
happens.
Definitely that's brought up in this movie, because the idea of, you know, making a documentary of people that don't want to have it made, that definitely shows up in this movie. And so... really, how much of the rules they twist, like, it seems like they're very much aware of what they're in the rights to do, but, you know, that still seems like it's an issue, although I mean, really, like just
hoop
the information that this movie presents, it's still, you know, even if you know, I'm sure all the details are out there if you really want to look for them, but still, the final message of the movie, that's still something worth talking about anyway, and
like,
it's really hard to
particular...
doubt anything that they're saying.
There's this sequence in Hoop Dreams where the Aggie family... First off, the film follows two kids and their attempt to become pro basketball players in the early 90s. And so there's this sequence that happens where one of the kids' family is hanging out in their house, and then the lights go out, and you find out that they didn't pay their electricity bill. And so now for, you know, the next week or so, until they can get their money together, that they were living in the dark. And there's a real ethical dilemma there, because the filmmakers are still in the house.
Yeah.
They're still documenting their subjects. Are did they give them money to turn the lights on? Did their life circumstance change because of that?
I mean, documentary filmmakers are supposed to be objective. You know, they're basically flies on the wall. Like,
exactly. But when you are put into a circumstance like that, it changes everything that you're working on, and you can't be objective. Like, I don't care who
only
you are.
If you're
in someone's house.
If you intervene, then yeah. But if you keep your distance.
Well, even if you don't intervene, I'm saying because you're in the moment, if you were in my house, and you didn't even like me, but if you're in my house, and my lights went out like that, you would just automatically go, what happened? Or... you wouldn't automatically jump to, did you not pay your electricity bill? How poor you are, but you would you know, feel a certain way that you would raise a certain question and you would, you know, maybe be like, oh, that sucks. Like,
but I think that is worth mentioning, though, and I don't, Hoop Dreams is not fresh in my mind at all, but I don't know if that happens within year two or three, and maybe at that point they're so used to having the crew around that it's just...
When you're that, when, you know, there's a lot on that film. I'm not saying it's a bad movie. I'm just saying, you know, I wrote a ton of paper about it. I'm very familiar with the ethical properties there because it, you know, most of the film, it's them, you know, flies on the wall. Like, there are some interview segments, but the majority of the film is them just following these boys' life for, I think it's like 8 years.
And then there are also moments where the person behind the camera, you can hear them asking questions. So
asking questions,
they definitely
are
involved. I don't, even in that scene, I don't know, something might have been said.
Yeah, no, it's definitely that scene, like they say something. And because they still have the light on the camera, so you can still see certain things. It's just that it's in pitch black. And so, yeah, there, you know, there's these questions raised, like, how far removed is the filmmaker from the source material? Like, I can tell you firsthand when I worked on my documentary that I hadn't met any of the subjects, and yet sitting in front of my edit bay for so long, looking at this footage, listening to these people, hearing their viewpoints, it felt like I knew them. And so when I did meet them, when I went to an event, so, you know, I helped out. I think I was the camera operator for something, but I was actually, quote unquote, on set. That it was really bizarre, the fact that I knew these people and yet they didn't know me. And I knew not super personal things about them, but I knew enough that they felt like friends and yet I was a stranger. And I felt like God, almost. Like, I was shaping how they're seen by other people, including strangers, and they had no input into that. And so that day, and then a couple of days after, or not days, but, you know, times after when I met them again, I still had this same kind of gut feeling. And it makes me think, well, how do real documentarians feel? Is this something that they even think about, or are they so concerned about the fame, the notoriety, and the money?
I don't know if it's necessarily fame. You know, it's things like they have to think about their subject, but then they also have to, you know, money is always going to be the issue on any film. I don't know how they handle budgets for documentaries. I mean, especially something like Hoop Dreams, because, you know, it is a similar investment to something like Boyhood, maybe. I mean, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you know, Boyhood is it's a fictional narrative, but that's a movie where you go to investors and you say, okay, I want this amount of money every year, and you won't see a return on your investment for 14 years. Like, I mean, that seems like on Hoop Dreams it could be like that long a risk. At least they say, hey, we want to do this for 4 years. Or on any other documentary where they've just been shooting for a long time, they just say, oh yeah, that's indefinitely what's going to happen. We're just going to keep asking for money as we go, and then we'll hopefully have something done.
No, I think they shot something like 500 hours of footage for Hoop Dreams.
Yeah, and that movie's like 3.5 hours at the end of it, right?
Yeah, it's miraculous. It's like you said, it's like Boyhood. You know, it's famous for a certain reason. It's about the chronicle of these boys' lives.
But you can definitely, you know, find parallels.
I'm just saying, but yeah, everything about it, like when you think about that long of production, when you think about how involved they were in these boys' lives and what, you know, having that kind of, like, my paper's title is actually Getting Shot in the Hood by a Different Weapon, Hoop Dreams and the Participatory Mode. I don't know. I think working on a documentary and taking documentary classes in college, it kind of just pushed me away from that kind of filmmaking. Like, I'm less interested because in certain cases, it can be just as fictionalized as a narrative film. If you look at something like Exit Through the Gift Shop, which people are still talking about because...
I mean, that's great.
Like, when you get to Mr. Brainwash or whatever the fuck his name is at the end of the movie... You're like, there's no way that you caught this on a documentary. There's no way. There's no way you made this happen
in a
film.
It's funny. You could say maybe the same thing about Tickled, for all I know. Because, that was the closest comparison. I felt like this was probably the most entertaining documentary I had seen since Exit Through the Gift Shop. And I love Exit Through the Gift Shop, but...
Yeah, it's a good movie.
You know, like,
that is a
documentary, one of the few where I think you can talk about the form of filmmaking as well as the actual narrative without having to worry about whether, you know, this is actually happening. Like, it's still a damn good movie, regardless of the quote-unquote facts. But, I mean, yeah, you know, I'm also just, I'm not interested in pursuing documentary filmmaking. I think for me, I'm just way too into trying to control the elements as opposed to just sitting back and seeing stuff happen.
Well, that's what's weird about documentary
filmmaking.
That's
the thing, though. You,
is that
behind the scenes, you do get to control.
Exactly.
Like,
you control a lot of it. You control who the camera's pointed at.
Yeah,
and
well, that's editing
depending
in
on
general.
That,
you
they're
control
gonna,
everything that people
well,
are seeing
the,
and
I'm
how
saying,
they're
well,
seeing
that's the
it.
Editing, but I'm saying in the moment when you're on, quote-unquote, set, when you're on location with your subjects, mm-hmm. who's getting pointed at, like who the camera is focused on is going to create an event that could have possibly not happened. You know, like when you're with your friends and someone takes out a phone and starts Snapchatting, you're going to act differently. And so who's the focal point in a given moment could change the entire course of events.
Yeah.
And then also when you start editing, you can change that even more and you get more control. But in some ways, a documentary, there's more artistry behind it because everything at the end of the day is responsible from the people that worked on it. Whereas a real movie, you know, a narrative production, like the script was written a certain way, the actors are there, they're getting direction from certain people, they're saying the lines that are on the page, it's looking a certain way because you have all the people that are working on the production and the design and all of these things. And then at the end of the day, yeah, then also an editor comes out and they work on it, and then you get ADR. Like, it is more fabricated. That's, you know, why generally people look at documentaries in a certain way, like, oh, it's educational, or I'm learning something, or like it's illuminating, or it's reality, you know. But at the end of the day, like, they're both films. They're, yeah. It's still part of Hollywood, even if it's not the studio system. Like, look at something like the Weinstein Company's Bully, the big push that film had, or Undefeated. Same story. I think mm-hmm. that was also the Weinsteins, which is also, like, for some fucking reason getting remade. Like, both of those films, I was watching them, and I saw both of them. Well, I still haven't seen Bully, but when I saw Undefeated, it was shortly thereafter I worked on my documentary, and I was watching certain segments, and I was like, this is totally made up.
At the same screening, maybe, for Undefeated.
No, I think I saw Undefeated on Netflix when it was still on there.
Okay, never mind. I was in Gary's class when I saw that.
Yeah, in Gary's class. Yeah, I remember watching it and going, oh, they fucking made this up. Like, there's a sequence towards the end where one of the kids apologizes to another one.
Yeah.
And I was like, there's no way throughout the whole film this guy's been a dick. You're going to tell me that just out of nowhere he decided to apologize?
I think
no.
Maybe he just realized, hey, there's cameras on me, and, you know,
I think it was
the coach. Maybe I don't want to be seen as an asshole.
No, I think it was the coach going, hey, you should go over there and apologize because he's having a bad day. I don't remember all the facts about that film, but I remember that sequence in particular, and I went, this is why I don't watch documentaries as much as I used to.
And
I've been too close to the sun that, like, I burned all appreciation. Like, Swiss Army Man is more a documentation of reality, in my opinion, with that, despite it being so fantastical.
I mean, it's like, yeah, it speaks more to, like,
just humanity.
Truth, like, I mean, the thoughts that Paul Dano have in that movie, you know, has, like, you know, it's just those things that no one ever really talks about, and that's what people do through art. You know, they express that. They can do that either through documentaries very clearly, or, like, you know, the point is made in Tickled, or hell, even in fiction. I mean, that's really, yeah, they kind of are one and the same. They're just presented differently, but that's kind of why we watch movies in general. We're trying to just find some sort of meaning, just for our lives to keep moving, or just something that relates to the human experience, regardless of, like, whatever genre it is, even if it's something as simple as good versus evil and a mindless blockbuster, then, you know, there you go.
Well, because of this conversation, my pick for Deck to Cinema next week is this film's not yet rated.
Yeah.
Don't rent it. Don't stream it. Buy it. Buy it. It's probably the most important documentary I've ever seen. Not in the, like, oh, like, you know, like, fuck, what's it called? The Thin Blue Line, like, oh, it changed uh-huh. someone's life type of way, but in the, oh, this changed Hollywood. The MPAA has since changed because of the release of that film, much in the same way that, like, Super Size Me encouraged McDonald's and all of fast food to change not just their corporate image, but also their public image. Thanks for listening. We hope it's been a pleasure. If you like this show and you want to hear more of our wonderful voices on a weekly basis, check out Two Cents, a recap of what's happened in film, TV, and tech news.
We're also on Debt to Cinema, where one or both of us crosses a title off our list of shame.
You can find all of our content at dollarreviews.net. Follow us on Twitter, or like us on Facebook at dollarreviews.
And we're also on Google Play Music, iTunes, Pocket Cast, TuneIn, Stitcher, SoundCloud, YouTube, just about anywhere on the internet with hours of content available to you for free. But for those of you that feel that the show is worth your dollar, you can send us a donation at patreon.com/dollarreviews. Contributions not only earn our undying love, but they also make it possible for us to improve our recording equipment and to give you the highest quality episodes possible. But more importantly, they'd be helping us acquire the content to review. You know, trips to the multiplex are expensive, and the more donations we receive, the more films we can review for your listening pleasure.
If you listen somewhere we're currently not available, you'd like to contribute some talking points, send a Death to Cinema request, or if you just want to laugh at us, you can do so by reaching out to us on social media or send an email to brian@dollarreviews.net.
Or you can email me as well, steve@dollarreviews.net.
You can follow me personally on Twitter, @BrianGillis, that's BRYONGILLIS, and now you know how to spell the email too, and also under the same name on the lovely site Letterboxd, which acts as my film diary, where I rate films I'm watching, write the occasional review, and even sometimes compile lists.
You can also find me on Twitter at @S_MTX, and also follow my film diary at Letterboxd under the same name, where I log everything I watch, and sometimes write brief reviews.
That's it for this week. Until next time, keep the change.